scripture reading today is from Luke 24, verses 1 through 12. But on the first day of the week, at early dawn, they came to the tomb, taking the spices that they had prepared. They found the stone rolled away from the tomb, but when they went in, they did not find the body. While they were perplexed about this, suddenly two men in dazzling cloths stood beside them. The women were terrified and bowed their faces to the ground, but the men said to them, "Why do you look for the living among the dead? He is not here, but has risen. Remember how he told you, while he was still in Galilee, that the Son of Man must be handed over to sinners and be crucified, and on the third day rise again." They remembered his words, and returning from the tomb, they told all this to the 11 and to the rest. Now it was Mary Magdalene, Joanna, Mary the mother of James, and the other women with them who told this to the apostles. But these words seemed to them an idle tale, and they did not believe them. But Peter got up and ran to the tomb. Stooping and looking in, he saw the linen cloths by themselves. Then he went home, amazed at what had happened. This is the word of God for the people of God.
My wife and I have lived in Northwest Ohio since the year 2005. I've come to learn that when Easter comes early, you can expect anything from the weather. Snow, sleet, cold, rain. Now, I spent a number of years in Dayton before they sent me up here. And we had a lot of mild winters and early springs there. One year, I can remember the forsythia was blooming at the end of February. And one year during Holy Week, it was so warm, so wonderfully warm, that I was driving down Volusia, which was the street where my house was, and I noticed one of my neighbors, flat on the ground, on the sidewalk, sprawled. And I thought maybe she had fallen and injured herself. And so I whipped the car over, got out, and I ran up to her, and I says, "Are you okay?" And she said, "Oh yeah, there's nothing wrong with me. It was just so delightful. The sidewalk looked so inviting. The sun felt so warm. And it's Easter week. How life is just so good." And she was so giddy. And I told that story that following Easter Sunday, a couple days later, Easter Sunday at a church, and they all broke out in laughter. The idea that Easter is a giddy time. When I moved up here, we didn't get a lot of those Holy Weeks. You wouldn't think a two-hour drive would make a big difference, but this wind, I mean, there's always wind here, and the light does all sorts of things. And yet, Easter being early this year, I sort of just written it off. It's going to be another one of those cold, damp, dark Easters. We're going to have to make our spirit, let the Spirit help us make our spirit. But, well, this morning there was frost on my grass. Shortly before Holy Thursday night, after a very dark, rainy day, it got very warm. It's sunny today. My wife tells me the temperature tomorrow is going to be 70. And so it looks like we're going to have one of those rare occasions where the feast and celebrative quality of this holiday, this day, this high day for we Christians, and the spring around us. I've been watching the flowers, and we have one daffodil blooming by our front steps. And then last week, I noticed the crocuses were coming up. So all around us, there's signs that life is being renewed. And that's what the whole Easter story is about. Life is being renewed. We saw the the sort of dark pictures on the video about it was supposed to be a dark day, it was supposed to be a sad day, a day of grief and pain and sorrow, and yet didn't turn out that way. My God, don't you hate it when things don't turn out the way you expected? You know, there are people that sort of live for the dark side, and when all of a sudden something breaks in and shines a wondrous light on life, it's like, oh, what's this about? Where did this come from? This year we talk about Luke's telling of the story. And each of the four gospel writers tell the story in their own way. And Luke, I think, is particularly interesting because of the relationship between the men and the women in the story. And because that relationship sort of gets at a key question that I always struggle with. And the question is really simple. It's why is it that some of us get this and some of us don't? You know, we can look at Matthew's account. You have two women going to the tomb, and there are two guards placed there by Herod. And the women are wondering who's going to roll away the stone. And during their conversation, an earthquake rolls through, and the stone rolls away. And they encounter an angel. And the women get it. And joyfully and amazed, they leave the tomb and they head back to tell the disciples. But the two guards, they were so wrapped in fear that they were, as Matthew describes it, like dead men. They don't get it at all. And in today's lesson, we're using Luke this year because this is the Lucan year, for those of you. We have a lectionary. Every 3 years we go through the entire Bible. Of course, that leaves John out. John sort of works himself in throughout all three of the years. And this is the Lucan year. We have another situation where, the way Luke tells the story, a whole bunch of women go to the tomb. And they get there. And there's two men dressed in dazzling cloths or clothes, and they say to the women, why are you looking for the living among the dead? And you know, they were going there for a specific job. You know, Jesus was interred right before the Sabbath, and the rules of the Sabbath would not allow anybody to do any work, and so the women were coming back Sunday morning and finishing the job of embalming Jesus' body. So they were going, they had a mission, they had a specific thing to do, and they were doing this out of their sense of love for Jesus and their sense of obligation. They want to make sure he has, in the end, a proper burial. So they're not even looking for the living among the dead. So I think the question that one of the men asks is so interesting. Why are you looking for the living among the dead? It never occurred to them. But he says, look, he's no longer here. And he tells them to go tell the disciples this good news that Christ is risen. And this group of women get giddy. Like that woman laying on the sidewalk. They're giddy. And they get it. And so they run back to where the disciples are. And they tell the disciples what happened. Now these guys, these men, who followed Jesus for 3 years, ate with him, listened to him, tried to impress him. Sometimes they succeeded, sometimes they didn't.
they hear the women tell the story, they're not going to get it. They don't get it. They dismiss the women for telling an idle tale. Now, you know as well as I know that throughout the history of humanity, men have had a habit of dismissing women for telling idle tales. And it's stupid that men do this, but we do it. You know, the male ego. We're not as macho as we think, and our ego is more fragile than we like to let on. And so we don't like women telling us anything. I keep thinking it's getting better. I really do. I've been graciously married to a woman who has taught me much. She always hated it when we first got married and we'd have an argument and I would flash my two master's degrees at her. She thought that was the cheapest thing in the world to do, but I did it. And I was always one who thought of myself as being pretty open. And finally, about the fourth or fifth time I did it, I think she really let me have it. And I began to realize, my God, I'm like those disciples. Idle tales. And you know, when you dismiss somebody for any reason, thinking that what they're telling you is an idle tale, you dismiss them, you're sort of acting like you're superior and better. And whatever it is they're trying to tell you, you don't need it. And I think sometimes we men have that problem too. Not all of us, just the more stupid ones of us. And I put myself in that camp because I've had to learn this stuff over the years. So the women get there and they tell this story, and the men are dismissing them for telling an idle tale. We don't know how much time lapses. We don't. Luke's very economical when he writes the gospel. So we don't know how long Peter is sitting there reflecting on what the women had said. It could have been a couple minutes, it could have been an hour, it could have been a couple hours. We don't know. But I had this vision of all the men sort of blowing off the women and laughing about it. And Peter sitting there and beginning to think a little bit about things Jesus had taught them, the hopes that Jesus inspired in him. And all of a sudden, he becomes a little curious. Becomes a bit a little curious. And Luke says he's the only one that does this. You know, the other gospels, you have other disciples going, but Luke gets this. Is Peter, he gets up. Heads off to the tomb. See that the stone is rolled away. Sticks his head in there and sees it the exact way these women had described it to him. And Luke said he became amazed. At that moment, he got it. He got this mystery. This resurrection, this gift, this transformational gift, he got it. And so he heads back. Of course, Luke gives us a couple more chapters. And the risen Lord has to really work in Luke's gospel to convince people. But he succeeds. But it is that cynicism, that arrogance, that sense of
knowing what they need to know, that was very difficult for them to overcome. The ones, like the women, who had developed a sense of curiosity and a sense of wonder, got it. And so today we deal with this all the time. I don't know how many people have shared with me over the course of the last 10, 15 years. They'll say, well, I'm not religious anymore. I don't need what you have. Or I'm spiritual, not religious. So I don't know what the big deal is. I think there's something in this idea that if we bring a measure of curiosity and wonder to this story, the power of it becomes very real. It weaves its way into our heart, and it reminds us who we belong to. And it reminds us that our divine parent is not going to throw us away, even at our death, not going to throw us away. And that there is a place for that piece of each of us to live forever. And it doesn't make any difference. It doesn't make any difference how greatly we may fail in life. It doesn't make any difference how badly we stumble. It doesn't make any difference how fallen we feel we are. This God of ours loves us like we belong to him. And Jesus' life, death, and resurrection is the reflection of that love. And if we want the joy and giddiness that comes from open our hearts, we have to have a measure of curiosity, a sense of wonder. And in Luke's gospel, the women have it. So it would be good for us not to dismiss them for telling idle tales. And in Luke's gospel, Peter finally figures it out, but he had to go be curious, look around, open his heart. And I think the same is true for all of us. There is something wonderfully amazing about the life we've been given. There is something subtly eternal about the Spirit that breathes in and through us. Even in the darkest moments, even with confronting the evil that exists in the world, and this week we've had to confront a bunch of it, there is something greater than all of that. Those of us with a little bit of curiosity and wonder will stumble into that. And those of us who find curiosity and wonder a difficult thing will be surely challenged. Our mission mission, the church's mission, I think, is to help everyone know they're loved, they're a blessing, and to help them find deep within themselves that sense of curiosity and wonder. So that Easter doesn't just become another day or another obligation. But a day where we can be giddy about our destiny. You are loved in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.